Hello everybody, and this side Vanshika, you are watching my channel Knowledge World. So today in this video, we are going to cover the chapter from trade to territory in the form of slide. In this form, you will be able to understand each and every concept and policy of the East India Company in this chapter, as we are going to study that how the Britishers came in India with the sole purpose of trading in India, attracted by the prosperity of India, and how their purpose slowly and gradually changed to acquiring and seizing territories and states in India. So all this we'll cover in this chapter, in this video. So let's study these points. Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal ruler, died in 1707. First of all, I would like to say that you should bring your book and open it and then read with us, so that you will be able to understand the concept in a better way. So Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal ruler, and Bahadur Shah Zafar was the only last Mughal ruler. He was not powerful, as we can say, because last powerful Mughal ruler was Aurangzeb, who died in 1707, and Bahadur Shah Zafar was forced to leave the kingdom in 1857. In 1600, East India Company, means the Britishers, acquired a charter. Charter is a agreement. It is an agreement from the ruler of England, means from their ruler. They acquired a charter to trade in India and mercantile companies in those days, primarily to make more profit. He is Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. You can see the painting. And Bahadur Shah Zafar. He is Bahadur Shah Zafar. At the corner, you can see at the edge. England ruler Queen Elizabeth. She is England Queen Elizabeth, who from whom the England people, the Britishers, acquired the charter to trade in India. So what are the points? Now let's again see the points. The sea route to India was discovered by Vasco da Gama in 1498, the point to be noted. Afterwards, French came to trade in India. Firstly, French came to firstly, what happened when Vasco da Gama discovered the sea route? He was a Portuguese explorer. So we can say that Portuguese firstly came in India. Then French came to trade in India with the same route, we can say. Then fine quality silk and cotton was produced in India. That's why they came to India, attracted by the prosperity of India, as I said in the right beginning of this video. Then in 17th to 18th century, the traders sank each other's ship, because there was competition when everybody is coming to India, attracted by the prosperity of India, because here is fine quality of silk, cotton, muslin, and you can say gems and spices also. So everybody is coming to India, everybody was coming to India to trade, to for the purpose of trading. But when we see that competition is around, then we start when they saw that competition is around, then they started sinking each other's ship, so that they'll not be able to trade in India to increase their problems, you can say that. Then effort to fortify settlements and carry profitable trade led to conflict amongst local rulers. So when there were the local rulers, those who were the local rulers, they wanted to, what they wanted to, they wanted to fortify the settlements, as you have studied in the previous class 7, garrison towns and fortifications they used to build. So this was the main reason of conflict, and they also wanted to carry profitable trade, and this led to conflict among the local rulers. He is Vasco da Gama, about whom we studied in the previous slide, and this is the sea route to India. Maybe you have studied about it in class 5th. Now again the points are here. The first factory of East India Company was set up on the banks of River Hooghly in 1651. So this is the major point, that the East India Company firstly set up their factory, the first factory in the banks of River Hooghly in 1651. So, next point is by 1696 it began building forts around the settlements. Means they started fortifying the settlements, or we can say this. By 1696 they did so. And then Kolkata was first Calicut, then Calcutta, and afterwards became Kolkata. So there are three variations in this. Firstly, it was called Calicut, then Calcutta, and then Kolkata. So there are three variations in this also. Farman is a royal edict or royal order. At that time, Murshid Kuli Khan was the Nawab of Bengal. When they settled up their factory, when they settled up their factory on the banks of River Hooghly. At that time, you can say that Murshid Kuli Khan was the Nawab of Bengal when they were fortifying the settlements and whatever they were doing, settling up. So this is the lo these the, this diagram is showing what? Local boats carrying goods from Madras. This is Murshid Kuli Khan, the ruler of Bengal at that time. The points are here again. After Aurangzeb's death, the Bengal Nawabs asserted their power and autonomy. When the last powerful ruler of Mughal dynasty, of Mughal rule, died, Aurangzeb, he was Aurangzeb, the last powerful Mughal ruler. Then every Nawab or every ruler started to exert their power or show that they are more powerful. They started to assert their power and autonomy. Then Murshid Kuli Khan was followed by Aliwardi Khan and then by Sirajuddaula as the Nawab of Bengal. So this is the hierarchy. Firstly, Murshid Kuli Khan was the ruler of Bengal, then Aliwardi Khan was the ruler, and then Sirajuddaula was the Nawab of Bengal. Then the conflicts led to confrontations and finally culminated in the famous Battle of Plassey. There were conflicts among the Nawabs, there were confrontations, there were then there were disagreements of each other's viewpoint. Then what all this led to was the first Battle of Plassey. This was the Battle of Plassey. Finally, these conflicts, these confrontations, disagreements, they led to Battle of Plassey. This is Aliwardi Khan, Sirajuddaula Khan, here. Aliwardi Khan died in 1756, and Aliwardi Khan was followed by Murshid Kuli Khan, and then Aliwardi Khan came, and then Sirajuddaula. So Aliwardi Khan died in 1756. Sirajuddaula became the Nawab of Bengal as he was following Aliwardi Khan. He was the next heir to the kingdom. Sirajuddaula marched 30,000 soldiers to the English factory at Qasim Bazaar, captured the company officials, locked the warehouse, disarmed all Englishmen, and blockaded English ships. Finally, in 1757, Robert Clive led the company's army against Sirajuddaula at Plassey. So, Aliwardi Khan died in 1756, and Sirajuddaula became the Nawab of Bengal. When he became the Nawab of Bengal, then he marched with 30,000 soldiers to the English factory, and which was at Qasim Bazaar. What he did was he captured the company officials and locked the warehouse, disarmed all Englishmen, and blockaded English ships. He also blockaded the English ships which were there. So he What he did was, he was taking a type of revenge with the Englishmen. And when Robert Clive in 1757, then he led the company's English East India Company army against Sirajuddaula at Plassey to take his revenge with him. He is Robert Clive, as you can see, and the points are here. Robert Clive promised Mir Jafar that if he wins the battle against Sirajuddaula, he will make him the Nawab of Bengal. Mir Jafar was a kind of chief of Sirajuddaula. So what he did was, Mir Jafar defeated his Nawab and he shaked hand with Robert Clive. And Robert Clive What he did was that Robert Clive promised Mir Jafar that if he will win the battle against Siraju Dola, then Mir Jafar will become the king of Bengal. Then Siraju Dola was assassinated and Mir Jafar was made the Nawab, but he was the puppet ruler. Mir Jafar was deposed because he was protesting for dignity and sovereignty and hence was replaced by Mir Qasim. Mir Jafar was a puppet ruler only. You can check in your book also. But after some time, he was protesting and he started to fight for his dignity and sovereignty. Then he started to feel like a king and he also wanted his dignity. He also wanted to be a real king, not a puppet king. So he started to protest. And when he started to protest, he was replaced and Mir Qasim, another ruler, was replaced against Mir Jafar. Mir Jafar was deposed. Mir Qasim lost the war at Buxar in 1764 and Mir Jafar was reinstalled. What happened that Mir Qasim, the same thing happened with Mir Qasim also, and he also lost the war at Buxar in 1764. You can check it in your book, The Battle of Buxar. In 1764, Mir Qasim lost this battle and what happened was Mir Jafar was reinstalled. He is Mir Qasim. The points are here. In 17th, 18th century, Nawabs had to pay 5 lakh rupees. Mir Jafar died in 1765 and Clive declared, "We must indeed become Nawabs ourselves." I should explain this first, that in 17th to 18th century, Nawabs had to pay 5 lakh rupees as revenue or something. And then what happened? These are the points. So these will help you to reconnect these situations and to learn the chapter in this way, in points. So we are studying in points. Mir Jafar died in 1765 and Clive declared, "We must indeed become Nawabs ourselves." So when Mir Jafar died in 1765, Clive declared that we should become Nawabs ourselves. That why we need someone puppet. Why do we need puppet ruler? We should become a ruler ourselves. We are Nawabs ourselves. So Clive collected 4,102 pounds of Indian fortune. Robert Clive committed suicide in 1774. Nawabs in English word was for Nawab. So this is a kind of review for you. He is Tipu Sultan, Tipu's toy tiger. Here are the points. Richard Wellesley had to pay a little part of his territory as a penalty. Hyder Ali was the ruler of Mysore from 1761 to 1782. Tipu Sultan stopped the export of sandalwood, pepper and cardamom. These are the three specific names. You must remember them. And another important point is Hyder and Tipu together were ambitious, arrogant and dangerous. So I hope it is given in a very clear language that Richard Wellesley paid a very little part of his territory as a penalty. These are the important points. Hyder Ali was the ruler of Mysore from this to this, and Tipu Sultan stopped the export of three basic things, sandalwood, pepper and cardamom. Hyder and Tipu together were ambitious, arrogant and dangerous. He is Richard Wellesley. Hyder Ali. Cornwallis receiving the sons of Tipu Sultan as hostages. Cornwallis. The important points are here. So let's read these points. From the late 18th century, British also wanted to destroy Maratha power. The important names are given here. You should note down these names as you have listened in the chapter also. Mahaji Sindhia and Nana Fadnavis were two famous Maratha soldiers who fought the battle in Panipat. Finally, in 1817 to 1819, Britishers crushed the Marathas. A new policy, paramountcy, was initiated by Lord Hastings. So, let me tell you the summary of this slide. That in 18th century, British wanted to crush the Maratha power. The second point is Mahaji Sindhia and Nana Fadnavis were the two Maratha soldiers who were fighting at the Battle of Panipat, and from 1817 to 1819, Britishers crushed the Marathas totally, and a new policy called the Paramountcy was initiated by Lord Hastings. Paramountcy means that they are paramount, Britishers are paramount, they are the superior. He is Maharaja Sindhya, Nana Fadnavis. The points are here, let's study. In late 13th century, East India Company began worrying about Russia. Now in 13th century, in late 13th century means in the starting of 14th century, Maharaja Ranjit Singh died in 1839. Lord Dalhousie was the Governor General from 1848 to 1856. In 1856, the company took over Awadh. Warren Hastings was one of the many important figures who played a significant role in company power expansion. So what happened was in 13th century, East India Company was a bit worried about Russia. Then in 1839, Maharaja Ranjit Singh died. And in 1848 to 1856, Lord Dalhousie was the Governor General. In 1856, the company took over Awadh. And Warren Hastings was one of the important figures who played a significant role in the expansion of the company. He is Maharaja Ranjit Singh, Lord Dalhousie, Warren Hastings. The points. From 1772, a new system of justice was established. Qazi is a word for court judge. In 1775, 11 pandits were asked to compile a digest of Hindu laws. They compiled a whole digest of Hindu laws. And in 1775, Savars are trained soldiers on horseback. These are some important terms merged in the points. The cavalry requirement of the company's army declined. So I hope this is clear. This is the trial of Warren Hastings. In the early 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military culture. British Empire was fighting in Burma, Afghanistan and Egypt, where soldiers were armed with muskets and matchlocks. These are also a type of weapons. You can see in your book, the revolt of 1857 gives us a glimpse in the world of sepoys. So what happened was in 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military culture, and the Britishers were fighting in Burma along with Afghanistan and Egypt with the soldiers, and the soldiers used weapons like muskets and matchlocks. 1857, the revolt of 1857 gives us a glimpse of, clear glimpse of in the word sepoys. So these are the questions. In which year did Aurangzeb die? It is 1707. Who discovered the sea route in India and when? So the rest you can answer yourself. Who discovered the sea route in India too and when? That is Vasco da Gama, the Portuguese explorer in 1498. Kolkata was first Calcutta, then Calcutta, and afterwards Kolkata. Aliwardi Khan died in which year, and in 1856 the company took over Dash. These are the questions which you will answer yourself. So this much was for today, and the chapter is over completely. I hope that you have get the glimpse of the main points of the chapter and got the main idea also. So bye bye for today. The chapter is over. If you like the video and the explanations, strike a like, share the video and subscribe to my channel for such explanations in different kind of methods. Please subscribe to the channel and press the bell button also to get the latest notifications. Thank you for watching the video. I hope you like it and got everything clear. So stay tuned with me and keep watching Knowledge World.